to speak up.
It's time to speak out.
Welcome to We Have a Voice.
Community discussions about Huntington's disease.
And juvenile Huntington's disease.
Show host James Valvano and co-host James Walters.
You are loved.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to We Have a Voice. I am your host, James Valvano, coming to you live from St. Cloud, Florida. Thanks for tuning in tonight to our very first broadcast. Joining me tonight is my awesome co-host, James Walters, from Guelph, Ontario, Canada, and our very special guest, Mary Etta Robertson, joining us from North Carolina. We Have a Voice Radio was created to give our international Huntington's and juvenile Huntington's disease peers and caregivers an opportunity to listen to and participate in conversations with our guests. Now, not all topics are going to be an easy task, but it is necessary for all of us to open up, allow others to hear what we have to experience and what we're going through in our community. We Have a Voice Radio will also provide hope and inspiration to all of our listeners through the stories and experiences of our guests. I want to take a moment to introduce my co-host, James Walters. When I first met James on Facebook, he really truly inspired me with everything that he does for our international community. After many, many Skype calls, I really got to know James, and I felt his passion for Huntington's disease and juvenile Huntington's disease advocacy. He's a true champion. When James agreed to join WeHaveAVoice.org as my Canadian business advisor, the entire team was so pleased. Now, James, I want to thank you so much for everything you do for us in the community, and thanks so much for being my co-host. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm very good this evening, James. Thanks for asking.
Staying warm or cold, huh?
It's raining today, my friend.
Well, many of our Facebook friends, they already know you. But what I want to do is I want to give you an opportunity to let our listeners hear more about you and your connection with Huntington's. Would you mind going ahead and telling our listeners?
Yeah, that's probably a good thing to do. I know many people have heard my story before, but the thing with Huntington's with me, it's all too often heard that it was always hidden in my family. My mother constantly told me as a young child that my father had shell shock. I believe this was pretty much to protect me, and you know, God bless her soul. Mm-hmm. And you know, even as I grew up and I finally started to realize that something different was going on with some of my sisters, and that it was very difficult, and a lot of times I sort of shied away from it. I didn't understand. I truly didn't understand. And this all started in 1964. My father had a frontal lobotomy performed on him. I would have to believe, and I still believe today, that back in those days, they didn't really know a heck of a lot. Even though the disease wasn't known, it was a pretty hard go. And my father lived for 14 years after that in a vegetative state. And he passed away when I was in boot camp for the Canadian Navy. The day I was told that he passed away, I didn't know what my feelings were. I didn't know the man, but I knew he was my father. And I wish I had known then what I know today. Things, you know, would have been much, much different. And through the course of all this time, you know, my sisters have been afflicted. And I sort of had my head in the sand for many, many, many years. And about 10 years ago or so, I pretty much lost the rest of my family within about a 4-year period. I lost a couple of sisters, brother, mother, brother-in-law, niece. And that was at that point I decided that I was going to move back to my hometown. And that is when I discovered the Huntington Society of Canada, all these wonderful Facebook groups that were here to answer all the questions. And believe me, I had plenty of them. And I just want to thank everybody that's helped me through all these times. You know, there were days back when my two of my sisters and my mom were in the same long-term care facility. And for the life of me, it was very, very difficult for me to actually visit there. I used to go into the cemetery next to that after a visit and sit there and cry for hours and hours.
Wow.
I've seen terrible things in my day. I've seen my sister stab my mom in the back of a hand with a dinner fork while eating Christmas dinner. You know, I've heard stories from my brother-in-law about my father throwing axes at them. Mm. And very, very difficult. But through the help with everybody that I've known, and I love all of you. You know, I learn something every day. I'm humbled every day.
As we all do, right?
You know, it's a hard go. But as for me, I'm a fighter. And I'm sure a lot of you know that I'm occasionally outspoken. But one thing I promise you'll get from me, and that's the truth, I really don't sugarcoat much. I do try and understand that, you know, a lot of things are very delicate. And usually at those points, I try not really to say a heck of a lot. But it's not that I don't sit here quietly in front of my computer screen with tears in my eyes, because that's pretty much a daily occurrence.
Yeah, I want everyone to know who's listening that I've learned a lot from James. James has really been a huge part of my life for the past several months. And James, I think everybody can agree that you are one heck of an advocate. And we love everything that you do. We love everything that you are. And I'm thankful for you to sharing that to everyone tonight. And I know that's not your entire story. Hopefully, you know, we'll be able to speak more about your background with Huntington's in future shows. But thank you, my friend. Thank you so much for sharing that. I know that was hard.
Yes. A little choked up.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, my friend. Well, now it is time to introduce our special guest, Miss Mary Etta Robertson. Now, guys, leading up to tonight's show, honestly, I wondered how in the world would I ever introduce Mary? What could I possibly say? And do I have enough time to say everything I want to say about this woman? It's just not possible to express everything I want to say, except for the simple fact that my friend Mary is an amazing caregiver, a supporter unlike anyone that I have ever known, one of the fairest, honest, giving, and loving individuals on this planet. And I have known Mary for a very, very long time, and I've been blessed to call her my friend, my sister. Mary has enriched my life and the lives of so many in our international HD and JHD community. And over the years, Mary and her husband Paul entered our lives, and we witnessed their love story and dedication to one another. We witnessed the true meaning of strength and hope. Now, we recently lost Mr. Paul. He earned his HD wings, and he joined the many HD-JHD warriors up in heaven. Tonight, I am blessed. We are blessed. As a community, we are blessed to welcome Mary to our show. Currently, the phone lines are closed, but we will be taking calls and comments later in the show. We want to give Mary an opportunity to speak. So, Mary, we love you, and thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you. I want to first say hi to all my HD and JHD family, and I want to thank you all for the sweet and kind words that you sent me. They really helped. And I pulled from your words my strength to go through this, losing the love of my life. I just want to say thank you to all of you. I have not been able to go through all the messages because it's a little hard right now. But I want to tell you thank you. I read some of them, and then I have to close down.
Right.
But I want you guys to know I love you all, and thank you very much.
Now, Mary, you know, we spoke, obviously, up until last month. You were going to be on the show anyhow.
Yes.
You know, and unfortunately, you know, things happen, and I am really thankful. I'm happy that you joined us, because like you just said, the overwhelming support that hit the social networks was truthfully something I have never seen. I've been, since 2009, in and out of social networks, and the outpouring has been so amazing, and, you know, you are loved, and I want everyone to understand that Mary and I have had conversations, and Mary has always been the type of person where she comes up with these wonderful expressions and spiritual answers and this overwhelming ability to rise above. And I want you to express to the listeners the days leading up to Paul's earning his wings.
Well, it started on a Thursday, and we noticed that he was just kind of looking off, and his aunt was here, and I told him, I said, something's not right with him, because he had eaten, but he after that, it was like he was in a daze. So when his cousin came, we called the hospice nurse, and she came out and she looked at him. We went in the other room and we talked, and she said, yeah, his breathing has changed. We couldn't get a pulse. It was so low. So his aunt, who's 85 years old, decides she's going to sit at his bed all night because she doesn't want him to be alone. Every time she thought he was woke, she would say, Paul, or Bo, they called him, you're not here by yourself. We're with you. Well, we had a lot of people coming in and out. Friday came, and I said, look, I love you guys, and thank you for being here for me. But throughout this disease, Paul and I have been together. It's been me and Paul. He's not going to pay us with all these people coming in and out of the house. So they left. Paul had not opened his eyes or made any movement for going into the second day. So I told him, I said, Paul, I need you to open your eyes for me. I need to tell you something. So he opened his eyes, and I told him that I was going to be okay. I said, Paul, I'm going to continue this fight for you. But there's an angel in this room, and when he reaches out his hand, you need to go with him. Mm. So he shook his head yes. And I said, one more thing I need you to do. I need you to open your eyes so we can take a selfie together. He had not opened his eyes for the 2 days, remember. He opened his eyes, he looked up at the camera, and we took a selfie.
Amazing.
That's the last picture I took with my husband.
Amazing.
Then we put on his Aaron Neville music. You know he loves Aaron Neville.
We all do. You're right.
By this time, the breathing was coming from his neck, so his head was bouncing back and forth. He laid his head on my shoulder. I laid my head on his. We listened to Aaron Neville, and within 10 minutes, my husband had passed. And then God gave me some strength that I never thought I would have. I got a pan of water, soap, washcloth, and a towel. I took off all the medical equipment from my husband. I gave him a bath. I put his granny cloth over his face. I wrapped him in a sheet, and I told him, Jesus was wrapped, and he rose. Paul, I'm wrapping you, and you will rise with a new body. Not a body that's riddled with Huntington's disease. You're going to be up straight. you're going to walk, you're going to dance, and you have people waiting for you.
Wow, Mary. Wow is all I have to say. I know you had specifically told me that Huntington's disease did not take your husband.
Right.
And the way you just expressed yourself, I'm sorry, I'm getting choked up myself, is just completely, ultimately amazing. And Paul is up there. Paul's up there with many of our loved ones. And I just want to, you know, once again, tell everyone that tonight's a little rough. And what I want to do is I want to open up the lines right now. So if you would like to call in and speak with Mary, please dial 407-545-4548 or connect with us on Skype. Now, this is the first time we're doing this, so we're hoping that we're not going to have any technical difficulties. But in the meantime, just to let you guys know, the chat is buzzing. We have people here saying, God bless you, Mary. Once again, if you are in the chat room, I don't want to say your name, but if you say that you would like for me to say your name, please go ahead and do so. But there's a lot of people in the chat room that are giving support, sweetheart. And so right now we're going to open up the lines, 407-545-4548. You can connect directly through Skype also. But James, are there any questions that you have right now? I'm monitoring Facebook as we speak. I'm monitoring all the social networks. So if you have any questions for Mary, for the show, please feel free to go ahead and do that now.
Yeah, actually, we did get some questions before the show. And the first question is from Carol. And she says, I am writing from Washington State and just wanted to thank you all for everything from We Have a Face and what each of you are doing for all of us. And this is the question for Mary. About caring for people in the late stages of HD. How many years did you have to puree food to feed your husband? I know you posted a lot in the caregivers group, but I think it would help many people with some tips. Thank you.
Well, it was on and off. Some days he was able to eat just soft, regular food. But I think within the last 3 years of Paul's life, I started to puree all of his meats. He ate a lot of potatoes because, you know, they need the calories. And I put gravy. I don't know how to make gravy, so I brought jar gravy. I put gravy on all of his food. But the key to it was to make it still taste good so that he would still enjoy the pureed food. But it all depends. No Huntington's patient is the same. I haven't found one in Paul's family that was the same as him. You kind of have to try it and see. But for 3 years, I pretty much pureed most of Paul's food.
Thank you, Mary. And the next question is from Amy. I'm living in Virginia, and I'm in a very hard position right now with my mother. She is not eating and losing so much weight. Mary, I know you posted about Paul, but how did you handle the times when he couldn't eat? I feel so guilty when he doesn't eat. I love you, Mary, and thank you for always being there.
Well, there were days that Paul didn't eat because sometimes he was too full because they eat a lot. And then they just get tired. To me, it seems like eating takes a lot out of them. They get tired. Really, I did not press Paul to eat. When he had days where he wouldn't eat good, I didn't stress out about it. I would just keep offering him stuff. As long as he was drinking the Ensure, the high-calorie juices, the shakes I would make him. So I didn't really press him to eat. But when he did start to eat again, then I really packed it on. So don't stress out about them not eating one day, half a day. But when they do go back to eating, then give them a lot of calories.
Now, guys, I have actually some comments from the chat room. Clarice Miller and Dion both send their love to you, Mary. Hugs and love from New York. Deb Madden, hugs and love from Baltimore, Maryland. Ian loves you here from St. Cloud. We have Lori Reason, who says, God bless you, Mary. Maureen Christina Eastman, also from Florida, sending her love. Sarah Parker Forster says that she sends her love. I'm just really, really pleased with the activity, and you know, everyone loves you. You can go ahead, James.
Yeah. And I love you too, Sister Mary.
Love you guys too.
And the next question is from Michelle. How many years have you been caring for Paul, and how do you find the strength to move on? My husband is bedbound, and you have given me so much strength. I love you.
That is a hard question. Well, number one, I have been caring for Paul for 15 years. And the plain answer to that is, if it wasn't for the faith I have in God, knowing that he's my strength, I would not have been able to do it. There are so many times that Paul was burning up with fever, not able to go to the bathroom, whatever, that I just literally had to sit down and open my Bible. There was nothing I could do for that fever except forgive him his medication. And walking the floor was not the answer. So I sat down and I opened my Bible and I started to read. The Lord has brought me through all of this.
Now we have additional comments. Kimberly Spears in Ohio, Mary is one true hero. She has always put herself last and Paul first. I love you all for what you have done and Mary and what Mary will do. Kimberly, we love you. Rich Wheeler from Canada says, my wife has HD. Mary, you are an inspiration.
Thank you.
And just so you know, Mr. Wheeler is from Newfoundland.
You know, to be honest with you, just a joke, he did type, and I didn't know how to say the other word. He said Newfoundland and Labrador?
Labrador.
Oh, see, you know, that's why I cut to the chase, you know. Sorry about that, Rich.
That's okay. You'll be in Canada next month. I'll buy you a map.
There you go. I got to learn somehow.
Yeah. And I do have one more thing I'd like to say to everyone.
Please do, yes.
I want you to know, just because Paul has passed, yes, I did take a break for a couple of weeks to get things straight. But I am in this fight till the end. I am literally going to have one of my braids in my hair dyed permanently blue, because I am in this fight until there is a cure. Because there is another Paul Robertson out there. There is another Mary Robertson out there that I think needs my help. So I'm not done by a long shot. I'm not done. I am still in this. I'm going to stay in it until we all get together for a cure has been found party.
Amen.
Yay.
There you go.
Yes.
We love you, Mary. You are awesome. You are totally awesome. We have some Go Mary in the chat room. Lori Reason says, awesome. This is just, Mary, you're so inspirational. It's just insane. It's just wonderful. I love it. You give so many people strength. And Paul is looking down at you saying, Mama, go on. Go, you know? Yeah, and I know you know that.
Yeah. I do.
That's for sure. You inspire me every day, young lady. And right along the same theme, it's a question from Barbara. And it's also, how do you continue to be so strong, Mary? That seems to be the theme of the evening, my dear.
Well, it reminds me of a little funny story Paul used to say. He cut his leg one day, and he literally took alcohol and poured it in his leg. And as he was pouring it, I was screaming. And he said to me, "You're not a Robertson, you're a chicken. I'm going to have to make you strong." He made me strong. Paul made me strong. With him being so pleasant, never complaining, even until the end, when we had nurses coming in here every day, turning him, doing this blood pressure, everything, he never even complained. He always gave him that wink, and they were like, "Oh, Paul, we love you." Until the end, he was winking at people.
I remember him winking and giving my love to my mama.
Yeah.
Yes, we have. I'm going through all the social networks right now, and I really can't keep up. Excuse me, guys. We have comments from people. I just don't have permission yet to say their names, but wonderful show so far, Mary. Etta gives me so much hope for caring for my husband. So proud of you all for bringing HD to the radio. We thank you so much. And once again, if you guys are going to post either in the chat room or through Facebook, feel free. Just let us know if we can use your name, because I know Miss Mary would love to hear from you guys. Lori Reason also states, "My mama has HD and she is listening with me. We admire you and your faith, Mary." Lori, you're awesome. Love to your mom.
Yes, kisses to your mom.
Yes. Any additional questions, James?
That was what I had from the previous show, my friend.
Okay.
And Marietta, you're one of the most wonderful, beautiful people I've ever met in my life, honey. Mm. You know, I've had the pleasure of actually spending a lot more time with you the last few days on Skype and stuff, and
yeah.
I mean, I get humbled by all the stuff I deal with every day, but I don't know. It seems to be when you're in my presence, I have this sort of like calmness over me. It's very hard to explain. It really is.
Yes.
And I can't wait to someday meet you in person. Huh?
And that will happen.
Yeah.
That will happen. Okay, well, let's take a quick break. We're going to do some announcements, and then we'll be right back, okay?
Sounds good to me, James. All right.
WeHaveAVoice.org wishes to thank our friends, educational partners, researchers, and supporters, Teva Pharmaceuticals, Dr. Jan Nolte, and Dr. Kyle Fink, and their amazing team at UC Davis Health System, HD Care, the Huntington's Disease Society of America, the Huntington Society of Canada, the Huntington Study Group, the Genetics Policy Institute, Greens Quality Construction, Inc., and Endeavor MyID Medical Alerts. On March 12th, WeHaveAVoice.org will hold its first bowling tournament, No Time to Spare, at the Orange Bowl Lanes in Kissimmee, Florida. On March 19th, we will be in Reidsville, North Carolina, for a premiere of the documentary, The Huntington's Disease Project, Removing the Mask. Joining us will be Mary Robertson, Sarah Parker Forster, and many more from the community. On April 23rd, we will be in Guelph, Canada for a premiere of the documentary. I will be there with James Walters and many more from his community. The Huntington's Disease Society of America is facilitating viewings of the documentary across their support groups nationally. Please contact your HDSA support group leader for more information. The Huntington Society of Canada will also be facilitating viewings of the documentary across their support groups in Canada. More information about our educational partnership will be announced very soon. HD Care in California is gearing up to facilitate viewings of the documentary across their support groups. Please contact Daniel Medina or Francis Sildana for more information. Help for HD International in California and Florida will be facilitating viewings of the documentary across their support groups as well. Please contact Melissa Biliardi and Sharon Thomason for more information. If you are an organization and want to schedule special educational viewings of the documentary, please contact us directly. Send us an email at film@wehaveaface.org. Stay tuned for additional scheduled events and news, or visit wehaveaface.org/events. Now back to our program.
All righty. Well, before I forget, speaking about the film, as we speak, Daniel Medina, with HD Care in California, is showing the international documentary to his support group right now. I also have a little bit of an update. Speaking with Louise Vetter at the HDSA, I believe this past weekend they had about 10 support groups view the film. So once again, I just want to highlight that if anyone's listening, contact us directly. If you wish to see the film via educational events at this time, and you are part of an HDSA support group, please contact them directly. Or if you have your own support group, just let us know and we'll help facilitate that. All right. Well, James, you know, we have something else that I want to talk about tonight.
Yes.
Now, the Snow Angels have completely, like, hit the map. It is one of the most amazing things that we've seen. I want to just back up the bus just one moment, because I know you're going to tell the story. I know you're going to. My cousin Michael Green in Jacksonville, Florida, he started the HD Ice Bucket Challenge, and this was a few months back. And, of course, for us here in Florida and warmer parts of the country, we were able to do that. So it was birthed by Michael Green from Green's Quality Construction, Inc. And now I'm going to go ahead and let you take over.
Oh, thank you, sir. Well, it seems Mr. Valvano was so kind to challenge me to the Ice Bucket Challenge while he was sitting beside his swimming pool in Florida. And obviously he wasn't paying attention to the weather here in Canada, as we were just in an ice storm warning. So needless to say, I wasn't about to go dump ice over my head in an ice storm. So sitting here thinking I'd got to do something. Can't let this chance go by.
Very innovative.
So I just I wandered off out in the middle of that ice storm and did a snow angel. And through this, another friend of mine who lives here in Canada, her and her family actually did this, and it was absolutely awesome. And her daughter actually took this to her school. Now, her school, 140 students and two teachers, and this was Holy Family Catholic School, in Wascatnow, Alberta. They did it, and it ended up being on CTV News in Edmonton. Now, this completely blew up social media. Mm-hmm. We had almost 45,000 hits from that. And needless to say, again, some other schools were challenged. Now, I'm kind of curious about this, because this was a... This was Notre Dame Elementary School in Bonnyville, Alberta. They had 362 students and 40 adults all do snow angels at the same time. And the comment I got from the picture that I received was, there were so many people, I couldn't get them all in the same picture. Now, my friend James, when he first saw this, he wasn't sure what it was. I think he thought it was a plane crash or something.
I was so beside myself. I said, oh, wow.
Yeah.
There were so many children. I had to do a triple take.
Yeah. God bless all these children and all the teachers and the parents. And I sort of tried to do a quick little tally today, but I know all the hits. It was well over 50,000.
Wow.
And that's awesome. I mean, just absolutely awesome. You know, and I've conveyed my love to all the people that were involved, you know, and I've made sure that the principals of the schools made announcements to let all these children know that what they did was from the heart. And these young kids will all grow up to be responsible, caring, loving adults.
Absolutely.
And, yeah, proud of every one of them.
Yeah, and the the individual anchor, and I cannot remember his name for the life of me right now, he called me from Canada and, you know, was just overwhelmed by the amount of shares. And it was also an opportune time to educate him on what exactly Huntington's and juvenile Huntington's disease is. And he spent at least 45 minutes with me on the phone. And, you know, we were thanking him so much for doing this. But in turn, he was so thankful to finally get a full depiction and description of what the two diseases are and how different they are, and which made it that much more, it gave more gravity to the fact that here children were doing something like this. So it is an amazing thing. And, you know, I don't know how that's going up there now. No snow, huh?
No snow at all, buddy. It was like 20 degrees 2 days ago.
See, Canada knows I'm coming, so I'm setting the heat up. Now, Miss Mary, my love.
Maybe they can make mud angels.
Hey, mud angels. We're going to do anything we can. I did get a response back from, let me see, Lori Reason, who is listening live right now with her mama. She says that she sends kisses right back to you, Mary, and she's giggling. Sarah Parker Foster is woohoo about the North Carolina visit, which is happening next week. And we have a question from Rich Wheeler. My wife is 51 years old. Her chorea is getting worse and her speech is quite slurred. She was diagnosed at age 47. Just wondering if your husband had similar signs and symptoms at the same time frame of his HD. Also, she has exhibited no signs of any mental issues caused by HD, just the physical. Sorry for being so long-winded, but don't worry about it, Rich. We love those questions. I already know the answer, and Mary, this is ironic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Paul did not have the chorea at all. And his speech got slurred very early, almost 3 years after his diagnosis. So the answer to your question is none of the Huntington's patients are the same. James, you want to add any?
Yeah, it goes back to what we tried to express in the film, and what we're trying to do, name the organization. There's so many grassroots organizations that exist right now that we're trying to educate the doctors. We're trying to get the message out there that chorea is not the paramount symptom. We have so many people on Facebook in all of the groups that we have that say, if we could live with the chorea, we'll be fine with that. It's the psychiatric. It's the emotional. It's the promiscuity. It's the anger. It's the violence that, you know, within the film, we say, you know, Huntington's disease is not, you can't just depict Huntington's disease as a movement disorder. One size does not fit all for this disease. And I had a very close friend today. I'm not going to say her name. She did post something in one of the groups on Facebook that says that she went to her doctor and her doctor said something to the case, and please don't hold me to this, but it's trying to do the best I can, that he looked at her and said, oh, well, you're not showing so many physical symptoms. You're okay. And here is our peer wanting to express to this doctor that give me a chance and explain to you the other symptoms that I'm going through. And I know this person dearly, and her pain resonates because so many people are not being heard by their doctor. And you know, I'm not downing or putting chorea to the side. I'm not, because obviously chorea has a very large portion within this disease. But our medical professionals, they have to understand that majority of people who have this disease, including myself, if they turned to me tomorrow and said, oh, you know what, you'll be able to just have the Korea for the rest of your life, I would be like, okay, no problem. So what if I trip a little bit? So what if I bump into stuff? But it is not what kills you. Korea does not kill you. And until we as a united front open our mouths, write letters to our doctors and say, listen, this is what we're experiencing. And you know, our doctors have to listen, because this is not a one-size-fits-all disease. I remember, Mary, I remember when you told me that Paul never had Korea. Do you remember how surprised I was?
Yeah.
Now, this was going back, because let's face it, we only knew what was told to us, what, 4 years, 5 years ago? We believed everything and anything that was told to us because, you know, quote-unquote, it was in stone. But until you reach out, until you are within these support groups on Facebook, and until you hear the voices or you see the writing of what these people are going through, for the love of God, Korea is not a problem. Now, of course, it becomes a problem, yes, when it comes to someone feeding themselves and losing their independence. I get it. I totally get it. And like I said, it's my opinion that I'm not downing or trying to put the Korea aside. But if we're going to be honest here, we have to talk about the other symptoms of this disease, or we're not going anywhere. Now, Sarah Parker Foster just wrote, did Paul have any dystonia or stiffness instead?
Yes, he did.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'd like to add something in here.
Please
too.
Do.
And this is from my own family. One of my relatives actually has almost no chorea as well, but the psychiatric symptoms are just, it's hard to explain. I mean, one day he was okay, and the next day it's, you know, the wheels come off the cart. Now his brother is the exact opposite. He has chorea so bad that actually when he gets on a city bus, he scares everybody. They're afraid.
Yeah.
You know, but like I say, one size doesn't fit all.
No.
You know, yet mentally he's still got it all together and everything else, but it's got to the point now where his career is so bad, he's hardly leaving the facilities.
Yeah.
Can I say something?
Please.
Sure.
I want to tell you something about when we had hospice here. This hospice nurse came in first time. She said she had looked on her computer at Paul's chart and it said Huntington's disease. Well, when she came in, she said, are they sure that he has Huntington's disease? Because everything I've ever known about Huntington's disease is they have chorea. Mm-mm. So it's something in what they're teaching in the medical book, the study book, the classes, the school. Something is there that tells them the major part of Huntington's disease is chorea.
Right.
That needs to be changed.
Yes. Well, you know exactly how the film, and we cannot wait, guys, everyone that's listening, we cannot wait for our community by large to watch the documentary, because what Mary is talking about is something so important, because although yes, chorea is a major part of this disease, but what people are not understanding, and what I should say people are slowly finally realizing, that just because you don't have chorea, people are being turned away from certain facilities, certain doctors, because they do not have the manifestation of chorea. But the problem is that the doctors are not looking clinically enough to see that the patient might not have chorea, but they are exhibiting psychiatric symptoms. They're exhibiting emotional depression, suicide, and that's a topic that, forget it, you talk about suicide and it's the biggest taboo ever. How can we be considered a rare disease group when our suicide rate is much higher is beyond me. So I pray and I hope, and we are working closely with many medical professionals who are finally realizing that the voice of the patient is paramount, that yes, chorea needs to be among the diagnostic criteria, but if someone, a family member, is saying that their loved one is being promiscuous, they're about to burn a house down, they're robbing a place, they're walking outside naked, their behavior in a public setting is beyond inappropriate, a doctor needs to recognize that these are the symptoms that should be recognized. And I apologize out there. I'm very passionate about this, and I don't mean to get on a soapbox about this, but anyone out there listening to my voice knows exactly where I'm coming from. I know James feels the same way. I know Mary feels the same way. You know, so it is definitely something that we as patients and patient advocates, we need to make sure that our doctors listen to us. So, you know, and by the way, Mary, honey, Belinda Walls Wilkerson says, love you, Miss Mary. You are my inspiration. The chat room is just wonderful. I'm trying to do like two things at once because Facebook is going crazy. But yeah, you know, we have to have these tough discussions. And I know that, Mary, you did your portion in the film with Paul, thank God. We had many people in the film that bridged those gaps, so to speak, with personal experiences, whether it be themselves or the loved one with HD. So I have hope, and we have to have hope, that our doctors will indeed, you know, change, update, whatever word you want to use, the diagnostic criteria, bottom line, needs to be reassessed.
Yes.
So, you know, and that's a whole other discussion in itself. But I wanted to switch it up a little bit with you, Mary. Everyone's been asking, you've been seeing it on Facebook, everyone wants to know about your future plans. And I will give you the honor, because I want you to tell the world where you will be going, what you will be doing, and how you will be advocating.
Well, as I said, as I said to James, with no disrespect to anyone, I still have a dog in this fight. I am going to continue to advocate. I am working with James, and we have a face. We have some trips planned, and because I can't remember everything, James is going to tell you about some of our trips. But, you know, I really wish and I pray, if the Lord give me the strength and the ability to do it, I would love to visit some of the families, be able to come out with maybe some husbands that are taking care of their wives and give them a break, or give them some information, you know, spend a couple of days, have some coffee with a few people, take awesome. Some selfies.
Awesome, your selfie collection.
Yeah, and if you guys remember, Paul always had a teddy bear under his arm, and his name was Teddy Love. So Teddy Love is going to be traveling with me. So we're going to have some selfies of him.
There you go.
But I'm going to work closely. James and I have some things that we really want to do for you guys. And he's going to tell you some of the stuff.
Well, with the commercial that came on, I'll reiterate a couple of things. But my family will be traveling to North Carolina next week, next Thursday. And we will be there for, I believe, 4 or 5 days. We're having the premiere at the Reidsville, North Carolina Holiday Inn Express. There is everything I'm going to say right now, you can go to wehaveaface.org/events. So if you happen to be in any of these areas, I will post it after the show. So then I come home, and then I go to Canada on April 23rd with our wonderful friend James Walters, where we're going to be doing a Canadian premiere at the University of Guelph, Ontario, Canada. I'll be spending a few days there with James. And then I come home, and to my loving, wonderful surprise, Miss Mary has decided that she is going to take me up on my offer to travel with me to California. We are going to be at the hdcare.org OC Marathon for Huntington's disease on May 1st. So we will both be meeting Daniel Medina and Francis Saldana for the very first time and their amazing team. And then we come back and we have a few days rest because I had to give Miss Mary rest. And then Louise Vetter cordially accepted my invite to visit the HDSA corporate in New York. So on May 11th, Mary and I will go up to their corporate center in New York, sit down with them, have Mary meet everyone, and to discuss the future educational partnership with the film. So we're really excited about that. That will be Mary's first time in New York. So get ready for that. That's why I moved away from New York and here in Florida.
And we're going to visit Clarice.
Yes, we are. We are going to go see Clarice Miller and Dion. Yes, we are. And then we come back. And then on May 22nd, we have our WeHaveAFace.org first annual convention here in Florida. So there'll be more information about that. And I'm really excited about that because it's about time. We worked really hard, and finally we can celebrate a year of being a 501c3 and have community members hopefully come and have a very country, St. Cloud, fun convention. And then lastly on the list so far, on June 3rd, Mary, myself, and Deb Madden will be going to the HDSA convention. We'll be there only for 2 days. We'll be there, I believe it's Friday and Saturday that we'll be there. And we were really blessed because Louise Vetter said that we can have a table to show our commitment to the educational agreement that we have with the film and partnership. So we have a lot on the map, and I'm very proud to have Mary as my board member for patient advocacy. So we're definitely going to rock and roll this year. We're going to help as many people as we possibly can. We have the Huntington's Disease Assistance Program that, thank God, we were blessed to have a good amount of funding. It's not a lot, but it's a good amount of funding. So there's so much that we're trying to pilot and release and help as many people as we can. And I've got my buddy here, James Walters, who has been doing such an amazing job helping We Have a Face in Canada. As many and may know, many may not know, we've tried so hard to bridge gaps. And finally, we have an amazing relationship with James and Canada. And I'd love for you to speak a little bit about that, James.
As most of you know, I'm also a member of the Grand River chapter of the Huntington Society of Canada. And when I first encountered WeHaveAFace.org, I was introduced to them through a few friends of mine. And I was, I sort of sat back and watched and saw who the players were and what they were doing. And there was something that James said that I knew as soon as I heard that. And it was I just want to tell the truth, and I don't want to hide anything. When we tell people what HD is and JHD, they need to know everything. There's no hiding certain facts. There's none of that. And I truly believe to this day that for anyone to truly understand this disease, you need to know absolutely everything about it. I don't want to hear someone say, oh, well, they didn't teach us that in school. I mean, that just makes no sense to me whatsoever, you know. And now and now that we've got things going here in Canada, I'm still working on a few things here to see if we can promote things better. And looking to do a few events here as well. And it's kind of weird. I just thought of something with my my friend Rich in Newfoundland. Do you think we could tip an iceberg over for HD?
Well, Mr. Rich just said James is the best, doing great work here in Canada. And then Linda Gerard Briggs, Jamie, you are a rock star. You are an inspiration to our family. And you see, I slipped because I want everyone to realize James has three names. when I speak with him, it's either James, Jamie, or Jamesy. And I screw it up, but at least he answers. There's two of us, so it's hard.
Yeah, so I'm looking forward to hopefully by the summertime or even the fall to see if we can get some things going, if it be ball tournaments or, you know, see if we can have some dog sled races or, you know.
Is there some really
neat stuff you can't have in Florida.
Is there enough is there enough duct tape? Because I'm going to need a load of that. Rich says, laugh out loud, not sure about tipping one over, but I can put you up on one for a photo op. There you go.
Yeah,
well, that I want to do. I'd love to do that, but I don't know. You're going to have a lot of duct tape to put me on a sled. Maybe I'll just do some filming of it, but you never know.
Yes.
And James, tell us about the bowling.
Oh, yes. This Saturday is going to be our very first bowling tournament called Strikeout HD. And No Time. Ooh, here it goes. I'm screwing that up. It's going to be called No Time to Spare. And it's going to be exciting. It's our very first one. The whole family's going. There's people from the community that's coming. We just need to continue to do a lot of fun stuff. So it's called No Time to Spare, and it is our first community bowling tournament, which will be taking place here in Kissimmee, Florida, on East Vine Street. And like I said before, if you want to know what all of our events are, go to wehaveaface.org/events. Reach out to any one of us at We Have a Face. We would love to do events in your area. When I say your, that means anyone who's listening. If you wish to have We Have a Face put on an event for you, if you would like to put on an event for We Have a Face, something that we can do together to spread awareness, please reach out to us. That's kind of our goal in 2016, is to finally get out to the community and finally, you know, meet the community and help the community. So, you know, everything is coming along slowly but surely, but we'll make it there. Maureen Eastman says, I will be there. Okay, I can't wait to see you, Maureen. But, a lot of things going on. And
tell Maureen to bowl a strike for me.
There you go. You heard that, Maureen, huh? Miss Mary wants you to bowl her a strike.
Because I can't bowl.
When you come to Florida, the family will take you out.
And I'd like to mention something else, too. With the Endeavor and the My ID bracelets.
Yes.
If you know of anybody who is not, like, financially that well off, and you know somebody that can use one of these, please just contact me. We have the ability that we can actually send some of these out free of charge worldwide. So don't hesitate. I see it now that, and I know many times from one of my sisters that, you know, if she had something that when these police officers grabbed her to indicate that, you know, it's not what you think it is, you know, and the bracelet's the best route to go. You know, I thought about, you know, I'm getting a bracelet for my nephew. I thought about the card, but he loses his wallet every 2 days, so there's no sense doing that. But the bracelet's really going to help. And also get out and make sure that you take your law enforcement toolkit, you know, and not just to the police officers, but any of the first responders, whether they be paramedics, firefighters, or normally the first people on the scene.
Absolutely. Sarah Parker Foster.
Yeah, it's important.
Yeah. Sarah Parker Foster says it's a great service and she wears hers all the time. I wear mine. And just to let everyone know who's listening, Daniel Medina of HD Care in California came to me months back and picked up the phone, called me. I said, hey, Daniel, what's going on? And he told me about this product, the My ID medical alert bracelets. And I was just completely taken. It's a no-brainer. With his help, we were able to facilitate an amazing relationship with Endeavor, who are the creators of the My ID bracelets, the cards, and the stickers. And we have a grant that we applied to Endeavor. So like James said, if you know someone who really truly needs the wristband, an ID card, or a sticker. Now, these stickers are amazing. You could put them on a wheelchair. You can put them on a car window, a license plate. The bottom line is, it's very simple. Anyone in the community with a cell phone can simply scan the individual sticker, card, bracelet, and it will come up with an amazing brief of what this individual is suffering with and the best way to help this individual. It's amazing. We have had many, many responses from police officers, firefighters, and EMS. They just love it. So we're offering that. So please reach out to James for Canada. Reach out to anyone here in America with We Have a Face. Daniel Medina, also reach out to him at HD Care. He and Francis, we are partnered in this educational program. So, you know, stay tuned because we're going to be piloting a larger platform where we're going to go to Mexico. We're hopefully going to make sure these are available in the UK and other countries. So Rich Wheeler just said, as a police officer, I have conducted presentations to fellow officers on recognizing HD, well received by all in attendance. A personal spin on the presentation using my wife's condition to bring home the message. Great, great, Rich. And hopefully we can get Rich a wristband and the ID card so that he can actually further facilitate education for his area. It's all about spreading the word and making the police officer, the EMS, or the firefighter, fire rescuers work easier so that they can identify and act as quickly as possible.
Yes, their jobs are hard enough as it is.
Yes, it's very true. Very
yes.
true.
And I just wanted to add something. You know, these bracelets are not just for people with Huntington's.
Correct.
We have some caregivers out there that have some health issues.
Correct.
That these would be very helpful. Diabetics, we have heart trouble, high blood pressure, all that. And it's so easy for medical professionals just to scan that and know, instead of you having to carry, you know, all your medicines. Am I right, James?
Very true. No, you hit it right on the head.
Yeah.
It is a 1-2-3 no-brainer. Like I said, when Daniel Medina brought it to me, maybe when we have Daniel on the show, he'll express to you, I almost had a heart attack because I was like, we need to have this now. And within 24 to 48 hours, I was already on the phone with Endeavor's upper management saying, how in the world can we do this? And they helped us. And then thankfully, we received a very nice grant. And we're now able to facilitate wristbands to those who really, truly cannot afford it. So it is as simple as 1-2-3. And let's be honest, Mary, you just said it. We can't exist if we don't have our caregivers healthy.
Right, right.
Now, we have another comment. I'm sorry. Aroline Cusado, I'm so sorry if I'm pronouncing the name wrong. Mary, you are one of the strongest women I know. Your faith in God and the unconditional love you and Mr. Paul shared has been an inspiration to me as well as others. Love and prayers, Mary. Thank you so much. Mary.
Thank you, Arlena. I know that's
okay.
You.
Okay. I am so bad with names. Please forgive me. But I really think that by having you on, Mary, thank you so much for inspiring us just everything that you are. And everything that you do is so appreciated. And we really, truly appreciate you coming on. We appreciate you coming on board. Life is just amazing with you. And the inspiration that you will give and the fight that you say you have in you. And I know you've got a dog in this fight. I know you will definitely help so many people. And I promise you, you're going to get many requests from people. I want you over for coffee. I want you in my living room. I want you here. So, you know, I want to thank you for coming on the show tonight. It means the world to me. And James, thank you so much for being my co-host, being my friend, and my daily Skype partner. And Lori just said, we haven't been able to afford the bracelet. How can I get Mama one? Lori, I will be in contact with you within the next 24 hours. Don't you worry. So that ends our show tonight. And I want to thank everyone for listening. For those of you who began to listen to the show, however you aren't able to listen from the beginning, all of our shows are taped. They will be accessible through iHeartRadio. They will be through the mobile app. We have a Face mobile app. They will be available through iTunes very soon. They are available through YouTube. James, am I missing anywhere? I think Twitter, SoundCloud. So basically, keep in touch with us, guys. We hope to announce a very another show soon. But as I start to travel within the next couple of weeks, we're going to have some taped shows and then upload them. Or we might have a live show, right, Mary? You never know.
Right.
You never know.
My Aunt Lean wants to be on the radio.
Well, then we've got to have a live show. Come on now. Then Aunt Aileen, I've got to have a show for her. All right, everyone, we love you. Please stay tuned. Follow us on Spreaker. And always, always remember, you are loved.
You are.
You are loved.